I would like to first of all thank God for this privilege in giving me this opportunity to help all of us to learn about this Book of Lamentations. And I would like to thank you all for coming. So we all know this week's book is the Book of Lamentations, and this is a book truly inspired by God, because we know all scripture is given by inspiration of God. And I would like to share that actually before I also didn't read this book. I have read it just over, like not in a deep manner, but this time when we learned it and read it in a deep way, each verse by verse, God showed many things, and I was surprised that this book has so many meanings. And I realized that, yes, we need to read the Bible very carefully. Each word and verse in the Bible holds great meaning. So before we learn about the Book of Lamentations, let us all bow our heads for prayer and ask God for His guidance. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for this time, Lord. Please bless all of us present here. And I ask, Lord, that you will give me a special blessing, the blessing of the Holy Spirit, Lord, that the book I'm going to present, the Book of Lamentations, that I might present whatever I say, may it be from the Holy Spirit, and may it inspire all of us so that we can know the time that we live in now is the time to get ready and prepare for your coming, Lord. Please give us all, and the brothers and sisters who are listening also, give them also the Holy Spirit so that they can the Spirit will help us to understand what we listen. Bless us and guide us. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. So we might think in our minds, why Lamentations? As we study this book, we are going to learn many new things. And I thank God for this, giving us this book in the Bible. Let us move on to the Book of Lamentations, the introduction to this book. Let's see what this book has. First of all, we see that Lamentations is the 25th book of the Bible. Out of all the 66 books, this is the 25th book. And then we see Lamentations is between the book Jeremiah and Ezekiel. We know Jeremiah, then Lamentations, then comes Ezekiel. And we see that New Testament has many books that has 5 chapters. But in the Old Testament, Lamentations is the only book that has 5 chapters. That's a speciality of this book. And we all know the author of this book is Prophet Jeremiah. And there is one thing that usually we don't know about this book, a beautiful thing. That is, Lamentations is a book of lament, of mourning, of crying out to God and expressing your state, your sadness. Prophet Jeremiah is expressing. We will see forward as we go. We are going to see how Prophet Jeremiah expresses his sadness and how God helps. But even though this book is a state of lament, we see that this book is actually very beautifully organized. If you see chapter 1 has 22 verses. Chapter 2 also has 22 verses. Chapter 3 has 22 into 3, which is 66 verses. Chapter 4 has again 22 verses. And chapter 5 has 22 verses. So we see that even though the prophet is lamenting here, he is beautifully lamenting in an organized manner. Even his lamenting is in an organized manner. And another beautiful thing about this book is, it is arranged in acrostic order, which means each chapter and each verse represents a letter in the Hebrew language. It's taken from the Hebrew letter. And if you want to know the letters, you can see in your Bible, in Psalms 119, it's given like Aleph, Bet, Gimel, all these letters. We will see the Hebrew letters in Psalms 119. It is each chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 4, and chapter 5, each verse has a letter, starts with a Hebrew letter. But chapter 3, which has 66 verses, in this, 3 verses have 1 letter. That is the beauty of this book. So, Moving on to the next slide, let us see the background about this Book of Lamentations. What is the background? So we are, everyone be ready, because we are going to see some very sad things, but God is going to turn all of that into beautiful things. So first of all, we set the background that Lamentations is a description about God's chosen city. And we know the chosen city of God is his people and the city of Jerusalem. So Lamentations describes, it does not describe the beauty and the splendor of Jerusalem. No, Lamentations is the book that describes the funeral of God's chosen city. And we don't see like other books, maybe Psalms is of rejoicing and happiness. The Book of Lamentations, it shows us a tear-stained portrait. It's full of tears and crying. The book itself is Lamentations. It shows us the once proud Jerusalem. It's now reduced to rubble and it's barren. And then we see, as we saw that each verse has a Hebrew alphabet. It starts with a Hebrew alphabet. So we can say, like, in English, A to Z. So we see that the prophet Jeremiah is literally weeping from A to Z. Means he is covering all the points and he is weeping. He progresses through each letter. And then one thing that is beautiful is Lamentations chapter 3 verse 23. We find this verse which says, "Great is thy faithfulness." So even though in the midst of this terrible affliction or holocaust, Jeremiah triumphantly is crying out, "O God, great is thy faithfulness." And then we see that in the face of death and destruction, where life seemingly is coming apart, Jeremiah is turning this tragedy into a triumph of faith. As we move forward, we are going to see how Jeremiah is lamenting, but then he turns this tragedy into a triumph of faith. And then we see that God has never failed Jeremiah in the past. And in the light of God, he knows and loves, Jeremiah finds hope and comfort. So Jeremiah is finding hope and comfort in God's word. So I want to ask you a question. Imagine you were going through a bad phase in your life and you are crying. Would we be able to write five alphabetically arranged poems, like such poems which is organized so well and lamenting in such a orderly manner? I think we wouldn't be able to do such a thing, because only the Spirit of God can help us turn the tragedy into a triumph of faith. Let us move on to the next slide, and we are going to see here what the chosen people of God had. Once upon a time, Jerusalem, God's chosen city, was powerful, but now it's come down. And let us see the change. So if you see chapter 1, verse 2, I would like to encourage you all, please keep a Bible in front of you and open the Book of Lamentations. And as I am quoting, see it with your own eyes. The Holy Spirit will help us understand more when we see it by ourselves. So if you see chapter 1, verse 2, you will see that the city of Jerusalem had many lovers. But as you go through the book, you see now there is no one to comfort her. She had lovers, but now there's no one to comfort her. And in the same verse, you see she even had many friends. But now all those friends have become enemies and they deal with her in a very bad way. We all might have experienced in our lives, maybe our friends have done something bad to us. We know how it feels. And here, Israel's friends have become her enemies. And verse 3, moving on to verse 3, we see that she had solemn feasts. But now no one comes to those feasts. Once upon a time, they had this feast of God. They used to pray and have assemblies and fellowship together. But now none of those things happen. She had gates, but now those gates are desolate. She had virgins. Now those virgins are afflicted. They are in bitterness. She had children, but those children are gone into captivity now. Verse 6, you can see that she had beauty, but now that beauty is departed from her. She had princes, but these princes are now fleeing from their pursuers. Normally, now if we say a prince, normally we imagine a good young man, strong, brave, facing his enemies, and who does not get defeated easily. But here, the princes of Jerusalem, they are fleeing from their enemies. That means they are weak, they are vulnerable, and they have to run away from their enemies who are pursuing them. Verse 7, you see that she had pleasant things, but now all she has is affliction and miseries in her life. And then verse 7, you also see that she had people. Many people were there, but now there is no one to help her. Verse 8 describes that she had honor. Once upon a time, Jerusalem had honor from the people. From the surrounding nations, they used to honor Jerusalem, saying, that is God's people. They are powerful. We cannot overcome them. But now everyone despises her. She does not have that honor anymore. Verse 10, we can find that she had the sanctuary, but now the enemy has spread out his hand in the sanctuary. Let us go on to the next slide, and there we can see, what did God do to his disobedient people? What did God do to his disobedient people? We are going to see some things that God allowed in the people of Jerusalem, because we will see why he allowed them in the forward slides we are going to see. But now first, let us see what God did to this city. If you see chapter 1, verse 5, you will see that the Lord afflicted her. She is afflicted. And then when you see chapter 1, verse 14, I'm sorry, 13, you see that he says that he sent fire into my bones. He spread a net for my feet. He turned me back. He made me desolate and faint all day. So we can see here how God has sent fire into their bones, and they are desolate and they are fainting the entire day. Verse 14, you see that the Lord had delivered me into their hands, from whom I am not able to rise up. So they are delivered into the hands of their enemy here, the children of Israel. And then verse 15, you see, the Lord hath trodden underfoot all my mighty men. Israel had mighty men, great men who used to win battles, great generals. But now all of them are trodden underfoot. They are defeated. And thou hast called an assembly against me to crush my young men. The Lord had trodden Judah as in a winepress. The Lord had commanded that adversaries should be round about. So we see here that the enemies are around Jerusalem, and the Lord has commanded them to be round about them. In verse 17, we see. Moving on, we see more of the things that God has done to his disobedient people. If we see in verse 2, chapter 2, verse 1, you see that God has covered himself with a cloud because of his anger. So before, the cloud of God used to be with Israel, shows his protection and approval. But now God has covered himself with a cloud in his anger. He is angry with Israel. And verse 1 says that he has cast down Israel's beauty from heaven to earth. We saw that Israel had beauty. Once upon a time, she was beautiful. But now the Lord has cast down her beauty from heaven to earth. Israel was God's footstool, but now we see in verse 1 only, we see that God is not remembering his footstool anymore. Moving on to verse 2, we see that God has swallowed up all the inhabitants, and he hath not pitied. He is not having pity. And then it says that God has thrown down the strongholds. He has brought them down to the ground in dishonor. We saw that Israel had honor, but now what has God done? He has brought them down to the ground, and they don't have that honor anymore. And they are cut off in fierce anger. Israel is cut off from God. He withdrew his right hand before the enemy. God's right hand shows his approval, his protection. But now he has withdrew his right hand. He removed his right hand, and Israel is left to face her enemy alone. And that's why, because God has removed his protection and approval from them, the enemies are winning. And instead of Israel winning, the enemies are pursuing them and winning over them. And verse 3, we say that God slew all who were pleasing to the eyes. Israel had many things that were pleasing to the eyes, but all are slain now. Israel had strongholds. Those strongholds are destroyed now. All we can see is increased mourning and lamentation. In chapter 2, verse 3, we can see increased mourning and lamentation. We see in verse 6 that everything is violently taken away. His tabernacle is violently taken away and his places of assembly. And verse 6 also says that he caused them to forget the solemn feasts and the Sabbath. And it says that God despised the king and the priest. Both the king and the priest are anointed people of God. In the children of Israel, God used to choose the king and give him his blessing. But here, and the priest also, God, were people of God. But here, God has despised them. God is despising the king and the priest. And verse 4 in chapter 2, we see that God has bent his bow like an enemy. We all know that in olden days, they used to have war with the bow and arrow. And when do they bend the bow? When they are about to shoot the arrow. So here it says that God has bent his bow like an enemy. And verse 7, we see that he has cast off his altar. He has disowned his sanctuary. He has given up into the hand of the enemy the walls of her palaces. So God has given up the children of Israel into the hands of the enemy. And verse 8 says that it's determined to lay in ruins the wall of Zion. So the wall of Zion is determined to lay in ruins. And then we see in verse chapter 2 only, it says that did not withdraw from destroying, caused rampart and the wall to lament. And he has destroyed and broken her bars, her king, her princess. The Lord had done which he has devised. We see that the Lord had done that which he has devised. If we go to the previous books of the Bible, it says God has already warned the Israelites, choose today whom you will serve. And if you obey the Lord, you will get blessing. If you disobey the Lord, you will get curse. And it's there in Deuteronomy. God says, curse be your garden, cursed will be your house, your family. And God has already warned his children of Israel. And many times if we read the book of Chronicles, the books of the kings, the judges, we see many times that Israel has backslided. And when they backslide, God allows the enemy to overpower them and the enemy takes them captive. And when they are captives, the children of Israel again cry to God and ask God's mercies, and God is merciful and he brings them back. Many times this has happened, and still the children of Israel have sinned again and again. And it says the Lord had done that which he has devised, which means he has already warned them, but they did not listen. So what he already warned them of, now they are experiencing that. Then it says he fulfilled his word that he commanded in the days of old. And he had thrown them down and he has not pitied. He caused the enemy to rejoice over thee. So we see here how the children of Israel are. Many of the beautiful things they had before, the beauty, the princess, the solemn feasts, the Sabbaths, and they were his footstool. They had his protection. His right hand of approval was with them. They had friends. All of that is taken away. And they are despised and afflicted now. And if you see in chapter 2, we will see many times that God's anger, words are used to describe God's anger in action. Like many verses of chapter 2, it has some word describing God's anger, such as wrath, fierce anger, fury, violently, indignation, abhorred, not pitied, slay, destroy, despise. All these words you will see in chapter 2. So chapter 2 shows God's judgments on his people. Moving on to the next, we see, we shall come to a principle that we all should be reminded of. That is, once saved, not always saved. How can we get this principle? How can we learn this from this Book of Lamentations? So I want to remind you again, before what the children of Israel had, how they were. Once upon a time, they were a city full of people. But now, what is their state? What is their situation? Now they are solitary. There is no one. It's lonely. Once upon a time, Israel was great among the nations. But now, she has become a widow. Once upon a time, she was a princess among the provinces. Now she is a slave. She was gold. But now that gold has become dim. That gold has changed. And it also says in chapter 4, verse 2, it describes her as the most fine gold. But that most fine gold has become clay now. And then they fed delicately. But now, what is her state? She has become desolate in the streets. Verse 5 in chapter 4, we find that she was brought up in scarlet. Scarlet it represents royalty and all those, like, you're brought up in, she was brought up in royalty. She had many things, but now she is left to embrace dunghills. And then we see that she was purer than snow. She was whiter than milk. She was ruddy in body than rubies. She was polished like sapphire. But now what is her state? She is not purer than snow. She is blacker than coal now. And she is not known in the streets. Her skin cleaveth to her bones. And she is withered like a stick. And she had joy once upon a time. But now there is no joy. Dancing means she had happiness. They had joy among themselves, but now everything is stopped. There's no joy. There's only mourning. There's only lament. There's crying. And how can we get a principle from this? We can see that once upon a time Israel was great. She had everything. She had God. She had fine gold. She had princess. She was city full of people. She was purer than snow. She had joy, but now in the Book of Lamentations, how do we see her? She is lonely. She is a widow. She is a slave. That gold has become dim. That gold became clay. She is desolate. She is embracing dunghills. She is withered like a stick, and she is blacker than coal, and she is mourning. So we get a lesson here. It does not mean we cannot say in our lives, I'm a third generation Adventist. My grandfather was a great missionary. He converted many people. My father is a pastor. I am an Adventist. I have taken baptism. So I will go to heaven. Being an Adventist or being a member of the church doesn't make us eligible for heaven. It is our character that decides our destiny. If now maybe we might be going through God's will, but that must not make us confident that now if I am walking in God's way, forever I will be correct. No. Every day our devotional life has to be brought up, and we have to nourish our devotional life every day, and we have to sanctify ourselves. Sanctification is a lifetime process. We have to keep that connection with God solid. It must not go down. If it goes down, then we will end up like the Israelites. But that connection with God must be kept. Then only we will not end up like the Israelites. So it's not, never believe that once saved, we are always saved. We must keep up that spiritual life with God. Moving on, we might be thinking now, seeing many verses, we see that how Israel is suffering, how once upon a time she had everything, but now she has nothing. So a question might come in our minds, why are God's people punished like this? What is the reason? Don't worry. In the Book of Lamentations, even though all her punishments are written, why these punishments are given upon them is also written. So please, I would encourage you all to look in your Bibles also. If you see in chapter 1, verse 5, we'll see that the Lord hath afflicted her for the multitude of her transgressions. The Bible itself says, why is she afflicted? She is afflicted because of the multitude of her transgressions. It just doesn't say transgressions here. It says multitude. Multitude means there were many transgressions that she committed. And chapter 1, verse 14 and verse 22 also, it says that she has done transgressions. And verse 8, if you see, it says Jerusalem hath grievously sinned. Therefore, she is removed. We see that the Bible here is using adjectives. It just doesn't say sinned. It says she has grievously sinned. And then it's in verse 9, you see that she has not remembered her last end. Therefore, she came down. Israel, many times she has fallen and the enemies have overcome her. But still she did not remember what happened to her before. She continued in her rebellion, and that is the reason she is come down terribly, the Bible says. And then in verse 10, it says, she had seen that the heathen enter into her sanctuary, whom thou didst command that they should not enter into thy congregation. The Lord already commanded them not to allow the heathen to enter into their sanctuary. But we see that she allowed them to enter. She mingled with the heathens. And God told, don't eat with them, don't drink with them, don't keep their possessions, don't intermarry with the heathens. But she did all those things. And then if you see chapter 1, verse 18, we see that Israel rebelled against his commandment. So she transgressed, she grievously sinned. Now it even says that she rebelled. And then verse 20 says she grievously rebelled. And chapter 2, verse 14, you see that have not discovered thine iniquity. So she has even committed iniquity. Chapter 3, verse 42 expresses two words. It says she transgressed and rebelled against God. And then 4, verse 6 says the punishment of thy iniquity. So if Israel is experiencing all this affliction, all this misery, because of the punishment of her iniquity. Verse 22 also says, punishment of thine iniquity. Moving on, let us see the effects of God's punishment. So we saw why Israel is punished, because of the multitude of her transgression, she is punished. Now let us see the effects of that punishment. What situation she is, what is she experiencing? Chapter 2, verse 9, you will see that the law is no more. Israel had God's law, but now that law, she does not hold any value. It's no more. Verse 9 says that they have no visions from the Lord. Means before, the prophets of God had visions and God spoke to them and used to tell the Israelites what to do. But now they are left alone and they have no visions from God. And verse 3, the Bible compares Israel as ostrich. It says they became cruel like the ostriches. So if we see, do a little bit research about the ostriches. These ostriches are mentioned cruel because they are careless about their children. And when they lay eggs, they usually don't care about these eggs. And they don't regard them much. So it says that Israel has become cruel like these ostriches. She doesn't care about her own family members. And verse 4 says, sucking babies, tongues, hungry and thirsty. Children asking for bread, but none to give. This is a sad situation. Even the babies are hungry. The children don't have food to eat. And then verse 10 says, the hands of the pitiful women have sodden their own children. And chapter 5, we see the inheritance once Israel had and the houses the people had, now that inheritance is given to strangers and that houses is given to the aliens. Verse 2 says, Israel has become like orphans, fatherless, mothers as widows. Once upon a time, God was their father, but now God is not theirs. They have become like orphans. They don't have a father. They don't have, and the mothers have become widows. And once upon a time, Israel had plenty of food and firewood to cook their food. They had water. But in chapter 5, verse 4, the children of Israel are crying out that we had food and water before, but now, even for our water and firewood, we have to pay money. They are crying out. And before, Israel had rest. Like, they didn't have to work so hard and exhaust themselves to their bone. But now, in chapter 5, verse 4, we see they are pursued and they have to labor without rest. Verse 8 says, servants rule over them. This is a humbling thing. They had servants, but now their servants are ruling over them. And there is no one to deliver them. There's no one to deliver the people of Israel from these people. And chapter 5, verse 10 says, their skin was black like an oven because of the terrible famine. It also describes of a famine. They are even having natural calamities. And it's very hot and there's famine, there's less water, less food. And verse 11 says, women and maids were abused. And the women of the children of Israel, they were abused and mistreated. And verse 12 says, the princes were hanged and faces of the elders was not honored. The elders there, they were not honored anymore. Once upon a time, they were honored, but now they are not honored. And the young men were taken to grinding mill, and children had to carry wood. So before the children had, they were carefree, they had time to play. The young men did not have to work and strive so much, but now they have no free time. They have to grind, go and do work for their enemies, and the children also have to carry wood. Verse 14, we see that the elders have ceased from the gate and young men their music. Before, at the gate, the elders used to sit and judge, and there was music. People were happy, but now all these have ceased. Verse 16 describes the crown was fallen from their heads, and woe to them. Crown in the Bible also also represents the honor. So now they have no honor. The honor has fallen from them, and it says, woe to them. And the chapter 5, verse 22 says, they were utterly rejected. The children of Israel, they were utterly rejected. So we see here so many points, the effects of God's punishment, how they have no house now. They have become cruel. They have to pay for their water and firewood. They are pursued by their enemies. They are orphans. They don't have family members. And they have no honor. And they are completely rejected by God. Moving on, we'll see in chapter 3 that even though this situation seems hopeless, and it seems very sad that God has left them and there's no hope for them. But in chapter 3, Jeremiah describes hope. We are going to see how hope comes from the Lord. So moving on, let us see in chapter 3, if we read from verse 1 to 18, you will find from verse 1 to 18, almost all the verses, Jeremiah uses this word, I, me, my. So he's describing like about himself, self. He says, I cannot get, I cry, my flesh, my skin, my strength and hope has perished. I cannot get out. So many, you can see it for yourself from verse 1 to 18. Jeremiah is saying, I. And when he says, I, he is in depression. You can see the way he talks. He is discouraged and he says, Lord, I don't have strength. My hope is perished. I cannot get out. I am crying rivers of water. Jeremiah is in depression. He's crying when he says I. But then we see a shift from verse 19 through 21. We see a shift here that Jeremiah remembers something. It says, remembering, I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. And it says, he was humbled. Verse 19 through 21, it shows how Jeremiah suddenly he remembers. And because he remembers something, he is humbled and he gets hope. Now, what does he remember? If you see in the following verses 22 through 39, you see many examples that Jeremiah has given from the Bible. So he remembered verses from the Bible. He remembered promises from Psalms and other books of the Bible. If you see, I'll give you some examples. He says, "The Lord is my portion. The Lord is good to them that wait for him. It is good for the man that he bear the yoke of his youth." So he has quoted many verses from the Bible here because he remembered the word of God. And because he remembered, he got hope. Now, one thing we have to remember is who brought this thing to remembrance? It is the Holy Spirit that brought these verses to remembrance. In our lives also, when we focus on ourselves and when we say, I was heartbroken, I am crying, I have no strength, then we will be discouraged like Jeremiah. We will be depressed. But if we cry out to God and pray, the Holy Spirit, if there is a verse in Bible which says, the Holy Spirit shall bring to your remembrance. So just like the Holy Spirit brought to remembrance for Jeremiah from the other books of the Bible, the Holy Spirit will bring in our lives also. He will bring remembrance from the Bible, the promises that God has for us. But keep in mind, the Holy Spirit will not just bring simply. We have to study God's word. It's only if we study God's word later, the Holy Spirit can remind us of those things that we studied. Psalms 119 says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart." We must hide God's word in our heart. It is then that the Holy Spirit will bring to remembrance those words that we have hidden in our heart. After that, after Jeremiah recalls or he remembers and he has hope and he's humble, we see that he brings a principle. And this is, we can see in verse 40. He says, let us search and try our ways and turn again to God. So this is another lesson for us. When God brings hope and we are humbled, we have to do these three things that Jeremiah did. One is he searched. He searched, is there something wrong in me that I'm doing? And is there something in my heart that is hindering me from speaking directly to God? He searched. And the second thing he did is he tried his ways. And the third thing he did is turn to the Lord. Normally in our lives, many times we just go to the third step. We just jump to repentance. We come to God and we just repent. But we should do this thing. We should search. What is wrong in us? What do we have to change? And we can only do this through the help of the Holy Spirit. And we need to try our ways, and then we can turn to the Lord, and the Lord will hear us. And then, if we see verse 52 through 57, we see a situation where Jeremiah expresses that his enemies are chasing him like a bird without a cause. They are chasing Jeremiah, and then they catch him and they cast him into a dungeon and they cover him with a stone. They cast a stone upon him and he is in the dungeon. And he describes in verse 54, "Waters overflowed over my head and I said, I am cut off." So Jeremiah got discouraged. He said, "I am cut off. I am no more." But then what? In verse 55, it says, "But I called upon thy name, O Lord, out of the low dungeon." Out of the lowest depths, Jeremiah remembered God and he cried to the Lord. And verse 57 says, "Thou drewest near in the day that I called upon thee. Thou saidst, fear not." So this is a beautiful verse. He says that when he called on the Lord drew to near to him and the Lord said, fear not. In our life also, maybe times will come where we are at our lowest. But like Jeremiah, don't focus on yourself. You will be depressed. Focus on God, and the Holy Spirit will bring to remembrance all his promises. And when we get those promises, we will get hope. And then we must search our ways, try our ways, and then we must turn to the Lord. And even though we are at our lowest, cry out to God, and he will say, fear not. Moving on, we see that so many promises God has given in the Book of Lamentations and how Jeremiah writes these beautiful promises that God has given. In verse 22 of chapter 3, you can see that it says, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. This is one of the most beautiful verses in the Bible, which says that every day the Lord's mercies are new. In verse 23, it says, they are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. If you and I, we are breathing now, it is because of the Lord's mercies. He is still compassionate to us. That is why we are still living right now. Verse 24 says, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke in his youth. For the Lord will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, yet he will have compassion according to the multitude of his mercies. For he doth not afflict willingly, nor grieve the heart of men. Here we see some words of love that God has given. Even though they had affliction, they had punishment from the Lord, the Lord says, he is with us. And it is because of his mercies that till now we are living and not consumed. He does not afflict us willingly, but it is because of our sins. We saw in the previous slides that it is because of Jerusalem's sins that she is being punished. So if anything happens in our life, we must remember that it is because maybe something is wrong in us that we are being chastised by the Lord. One lesson I would like to bring is that sometimes we misquote the verse, Romans 8 verse 28. It says that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord. So we might misquote this sometimes. Sometimes there might come some affliction in our life and we say that, yes, God is working for some good. But sometimes we might not, yes, God is doing it for a good, but we might not think it in this way, that maybe God is bringing this affliction in my life so that I might understand what wrong I am doing. Maybe he is rebuking me, chastising me. It says God rebukes and chastens everyone that he loves. So next time when we have an affliction in our life, we must pray and ask God, Lord, maybe there's something wrong between you and me. I'm doing a sin that is hindering me from being close to you. We must pray and ask God, what is that thing between us? And if God is chastising us, he will show us and we must turn from our ways. Moving on, we can see some practical applications from this book of Lamentations. The first point is, we must beware of beauty. We saw that Israel had beauty once upon a time. She just didn't have beauty. She was the perfection of beauty. She was the joy of the whole world. But what happened? Chapter 1, verse 6, you will find that all her beauty is departed. And in chapter 2, verse 1, you find that the Lord has cast down from heaven unto the earth the beauty of Israel. All that beauty, that vain beauty, is cast down. So in our life, as young people, we all get the temptation to show our become beautiful and try to show off our beauty outwardly. But the Lord says, a meek and gentle spirit is what the Lord loves. That is beauty. God loves inside. He sees inside our heart, not the outside. So we must not adorn ourselves with outside beauty, putting makeup and jewelry and all those things. We must adorn our inner character. We must make our character beautiful, have the fruits of the Spirit. We must be loving. We must be joyful. We must be patient and kind to the people. That is true beauty. So we must not focus on our outward beauty. The second practical application is beware of sacrilege. You must not take the holy things, the sacred things must not be taken carelessly. Israel, we saw that Israel allowed the heathen to enter the sanctuary. They respected not the persons of the priests. They favored not the elders. The anger of the Lord scattered them. He will no more regard them. The Israelites did not respect the priests and the elders. The priests are God's own anointed people who work in the sanctuary. But Israel did not respect them. Because of that, the anger of the Lord was scattered and he did not regard them anymore. And the next point we see is beware of iniquity. We see iniquity is something, a sin, a wrongdoing that we cherish in our hearts, like we love it. For example, we might all have this experience that we stop doing some bad thing, but then we still cherish it. Example, before we used to watch secular content like movies and maybe secular songs, but now we stopped watching them. But the thing is, we still talk about it. And when we talk about it, we enjoy talking about it and we remember it and we miss those days. That means we are still cherishing it. We stopped it, but we are cherishing it. That's an iniquity. And another example is, maybe before we used to use a lot of makeup and jewelry, but then we came to know that this is wrong. So we stopped using makeup and jewelry. But then if you see the wallpaper on your phone, it's the old photo in which you are wearing makeup and full jewelry. That is cherishing the sin. That means you still haven't 100% given it up. When we find out some wrong in ourselves, we have to completely give it up, or else that becomes iniquity and we continue cherishing those sins that we used to commit, even though we are not committing them now. And another practical application is beware of rebellion. The word rebellion in chapter 1 is found 3 times. The word rebellion is found 3 times, the word iniquity is found 3 times, and the word transgression is found 3 times. In the whole book of Lamentations, these 3 words are found 3 times. Iniquity, rebellion, and transgression. So these words are very important. We must not be like the Israelites and be rebellious in our life. Rebellion means we are willfully persisting in sin. Despite having the knowledge of God's will, we know the Ten Commandments says don't steal, but we still steal. It says remember the Sabbath, but we still break the Sabbath. Maybe we broke the Sabbath, we wrote an exam on the Sabbath, or we saw something secular, some secular video on the Sabbath. All these are rebelliousness. Because as Adventists, from small, we are taught, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And then still, we persist in doing that sin. This is outright rebellion. And willfully, we are persisting in that sin and doing against God's will. So we must beware of this. We must beware of this wrongdoing. And another thing we must be aware of is transgressions. The word transgressions also is repeated thrice in this book of Lamentations. You can see it in chapter 1, verse 5, in verse 14, and in verse 22. What is transgression? Transgression is sin or wrongdoing. Whatever we do repeatedly, when we do something, we repeat it again and again, it becomes our habit, and eventually it becomes our character. Like, we all know that to make something our habit, we should do it for 21 days and then it becomes a habit. So that transgression is something like this. We do it again and again and then it becomes a habit and we get used to it. And then eventually it becomes our character. But if we practice this, even little sins, it becomes our character. And this unfaithfulness, one day it will prove our ruin. For example, laziness. That is also a sin. Or telling lies or being careless. These also are sins and transgressions. So Israel fell because of rebellion, because of iniquity, because of transgressions, and because of her beauty. And we also see in the Bible one more person who fell from heaven because they were proud of their beauty. That is Lucifer. So we must keep these lessons in mind and learn from the children of Israel that we should not do this mistakes like them. Moving on, let us see the beauty of Lamentations. The some of the beautiful verses and the comparisons that we can see. In verse 1, we see, in chapter 1, verse 18, we can see that Israel was princess, but then she became a slave. But it says, yet the Lord is righteous. And then we see she was perfect, from perfection of beauty to dust and sackcloth. Yet the Lord fulfilled his word. Okay. And then once upon a time she had light, but then all became darkness. But still Jeremiah says, the Lord is good. And next it says, she was purer than snow, but then she became blacker than coal. But it says, he will no more carry thee away into captivity. We can see that Jeremiah is turning these tragedies into into triumph of faith. And then we see that from dancing to mourning, yet thou, O Lord, remainest forever, thy throne from generation to generation. So even through the tragedies and through the affliction, even though life is hard, Jeremiah is praising God and he is bringing beauty from these things. So as we saw in the Book of Lamentations, we must not commit those mistakes that the children of Israel did. There is a verse in the Bible that says, scripture is given by inspiration of God. And then it says that all things were given to us as examples. All these things are examples for us. God has given us. So we should understand that Israel, which was once upon a time great among the nations, she fell. And how she fell, we saw because of her iniquity, her transgression, and her sins, and her rebelliousness. So let us learn the lesson and example that we do not commit this mistake, but we learn from this children of Israel to obey God. And when the Spirit of God is convicting us, right now is the best time to change and turn back to Him. Let us try our hearts, search our ways, and turn ourselves to God. And He will give us hope. Well, let us not focus on ourselves, me, myself, my depression, my sadness. If we focus on ourselves, we will be discouraged, like how Jeremiah was discouraged. But if we pray, God will show us His promises, and we will be hopeful, and we will see beauty, and we will turn this affliction into a blessing for our lives. And God will, the chastisement that God has brought upon us, we will understand and we will change our lives. Thank you so much. And I hope God has blessed us and made us understand something from this Book of Lamentations. And I encourage you all to personally go and study this Book of Lamentations, verse by verse, and ask the Spirit of God to teach you and show you all the meanings, because we have just an hour here to discuss and understand. But you have your personal time, you have a lot of time, and during that time you can ask the Lord to show verse by verse the meaning of this book. And not only the Book of Lamentations, all the books in the Bible, it is equally important for us and we must study it. Thank you so much for listening. Before ending, I would like to have a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for blessing us and giving us your Holy Spirit, Lord. Thank you for helping us to learn some lessons from the Book of Lamentations. Lord, help us to keep them in mind. And as we go now to rest for the night, please be with each and everyone. Give us a good rest and sleep. Lord, help us to keep this Sabbath day holy tomorrow and do everything according to your will. Bless us, dear Lord. Guide us and help us all to continue studying your word and to become closer to you. And help us not to think that once saved, we are always saved, but help us to continue that spiritual walk with you and renew our, submit ourselves to you every day and renew our spiritual life with you every day, Lord. Help us to keep that connection with you. Thank you for hearing my prayer. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.